a 99-cent app sale for them is, I think, important. In the interest of time, I won't go into too much detail on this, but I do kind of use this repertoire concept a lot. If you want, ask me later, I'll tell you more about it. But I like it as a term. It's not quite ecology, it's not quite kind of the heavy-duty anthropological approaches to tech and society, but I think it allowed me to kind of link the affordance of devices to the skills that people have, and talk about everyone having a repertoire, and some repertoires being better in enabling effective use than others. This does set up stratification issues. I think I covered this slide, so let me do this as a... I've got like three conclusion slides, is that okay? Or two, if I need to skip one. So, metered mindset. We've got to fix it. We need to fix it fairly. We need to fix it in a way that it doesn't get fixed for us in a way that in the long run isn't going to be helpful. So a lot of the controversy around internet.org and the kind of outsourcing editorial decisions and curation of the net and making decisions about what's good for a community to Palo Alto is something I think is representative of how tense this is right now and how important it is to get that right. Mobile-centric production scenarios is not mobile-only scenarios. I'm not saying we need to make everybody's phone the place where they're going to write a novel, nor am I saying that everybody needs to write a novel. I'm saying that if there's anybody in the community who wants to write a novel, it's in the interest of the community to figure out how to get that person the digital tools they need to write the best novel they can. And that means there's still a role for shared access. And generative participation, you know, again, some of this is editorial control stuff. And there's some stuff about where who gets to write apps, which kind of comes from this gatekeeper thing we've got with fewer stores in digital spaces being more responsible for kind of our software lives than ever before, and there being many countries in Africa where a developer can write an app, but can't get paid for an app, you know, and that's got to get fixed. So, as my conclusion, I got two. This is it. This is my real conclusion. Then there's a South Africa conclusion. My real conclusion is, let's get rid of M4D as a term. It's partly my fault, not entirely, but I was writing about it early, and I certainly did nothing early on to stop it. And now I see the error in my ways. I think it does a disservice to the interconnectedness of the internet to fly a flag around M4D. ICTD is fine, but we really have to get back to a place where we're looking at a range of devices, a range of networks, and a range of services that are being touched by them. And I hate to have to rush this, but I do. This is my South Africa road slide. It's not a very good road, but it's a South African road, right? And I'm putting this up only as my last slide because I think this is probably, if not my last, and certainly one of my last talks here in South Africa. I'm moving back to the U.S. after about 5 or 6 years living here. And it's hard, and I'm going to miss it tremendously for a whole variety of reasons, for, you know, friends and the wonderful country that this is and all that. But what you guys, what in our sort of professional setting that we have here, I should talk to you about the professional bits of this slide, why South Africa has been such an amazing place to do the kind of work, and how the book that I wrote wouldn't have been written if it hadn't been living anywhere else. Right? And that's because of the particular context for here, not just the rich and poor thing, which I think is obvious but important, that you can see any manifestation of technology here. There's a rural-urban thing, which means you can do any of the field work you want to do, and you can see kind of any challenge here. There's the hope and despair and hope and enthusiasm and dismay all happening at the same time, and that it's a good kind of fertile place to do work as well, incredibly complex. And, you know, but then also I think even at the edges with around the words development and stuff, that there are ways in which it's not just a development challenge here, it's a justice challenge, and it's a participation challenge and inclusion challenges, and the lines between what's strictly economic and what's about, you know, kind of the whole person and the kind of whole citizen and all that are so apparent here. They're so contested and there's so much going on, and the people who are trying to solve these are trying to solve such complex challenges simultaneously that it is no wonder that so much good ICTD scholarship comes out of South Africa. And good practice as well. Incredibly innovative NGOs and researchers, you know, whole research groups that lead the world are working here, and that's because of the South African context. So I thank all of you, ones I know well, ones I don't know so well, had great colleagues over the years. Thanks for letting me talk a few minutes over time. And thanks for being so wonderful as colleagues. Thank you.
Thank you for the talk, Jonathan, and thank you for helping us to set the theme for some of the conversations that we'll be having here today. We will take a few questions, opening up to the floor. If you need a mic, I can bring it down to you. So, any questions?
I went over time, too, so if you guys want to
come. No, there's enough time.
Last slide where you talked about we should get rid of NCD.
Yeah.
So that's a very interesting statement. One, because there's already, you know, a whole broad field. I mean, there's already the theme of end for development, including a conference with the same name. And so I'm just interested in hearing about and replace it with what?
Well, ICTD, M4D comes from a troubled parent, right, which is ICTD, which itself is incredibly complex and has just enough letters to be problematic as an acronym, right? Because every single one of those terms is because when you throw the four in the middle and it's even worse, right? Who's doing what on whose behalf and all that. And, you know, the ICT for D as a field fights among itself and keeps working on what that should be. But at least it's trying to build sort of generalizable knowledge and practice that isn't hung on a particular technology, right? And so at least we get better theories of kind of communication practices and what it means to build better technologies. The M4D thing, I think a little bit has been hijacked by the mobile operators. It's been replicated in a way that we end up sort of reinventing the wheel. There's a lot of things that happen under the M4D flag that are almost settled discussions, where it's just a distraction. And also we're gonna get to a place where it's gonna be post-mobile pretty soon as well. The last thing I'll say on this is, if you're using the phone, the handset, to bounce right through and get to a Twitter server or a Facebook server, which is also happy to do the same thing for you if you're on a PC, or YouTube, and is also happy to do it on your television, then kind of isolating your lens to what's happening on the phone isn't gonna help you in the long run. So I'm not saying give up on ICTD, just the M4D. Get back with the mainstream. That's the next time.
Jonathan, I'm totally fascinated by both your categorizations, because I think the idea of mobility and the sense of place and battling with geography and virtual geography is very interesting. But that wasn't what I wanted to say. I was very interested in when you talked about, if you like, the constraints. And you, I think you spoke about the ability of mobile internet for protest and organisation and mobilisation. And I've been involved in a number of social, you know, in a number of protests myself. But one thing, and I found it very useful, but having said that, if you look at what happened in the Iranian Revolution, and so I suppose what I'm questioning, and I'm just curious to see whether you agree, is if you take the Iranian Revolution as an example and the killing of leader Soltani, what happened there was we all had an amazing consciousness of what was going on. You could argue that the Iranian government has shifted slightly since then. But then again, the Iranian government also actively monitors social media, and there is a great deal of censorship. So, you know, this sort of Castelian idea that, you know, somehow the networks are going to redistribute power, it seems to me that the basic hegemony of what's going on hasn't changed that much. And I think you've alluded to that as well when you talk about the concentration of ownership of networks.
Yeah, and that's actually where I put the privacy and surveillance points that I do bring out of the book but didn't make on the slides are in that last chapter.
Yeah.
And if they are a constraint. And what's interesting to me is the difference between the kind of what assertions we make about the internet in general and the assertions we make about the more mobile internet, an internet with more mobile characteristics.
Yeah.
And on the plus side, you get more affordances, more degrees of freedom to do protest in real time because your devices are with you.
Absolutely.
You're sending things out. You're knowing where the police are. There's all sorts of things you do.
You can record the police.
Right, all these things, right?
You can post it.
The thing that's crazy is I think people are rightly concerned about their computers. They should be even more concerned about their phones. And the lack of visibility, lack of transparency about how much the phones are tracking you all the time is part of that kind of concentration of ownership. They're tracking us all the time, either because the government wants it or because it's in somebody's market interest to track us all the time. So even more than was the case with the Web 1 or whatever, the classic internet, the more mobile internet is a trackable, privacy-destroying internet. And that's a huge problem.
One more question while we wait for this to move.
I wanted to understand you, excuse me, I mean, how to phrase it. There is in South Africa, thank you for summarizing it, I took it as meaning we live in an interesting place.
Oh, yeah.
Is a sensitivity about identity and the effect that this globalization is going to have on that. And now look at those maps of all the spreading out. And do you touch on that, the context where we say we don't want to be taken over by everybody. We don't want this uniformity of access to everything because it ends up being an access to the Facebooks and the, for example, the protests in India against the initiatives there on the internet.
Yeah. Yeah. So there's an identity thing. There's an identity question and there's a sort of a heterogeneity or diversity question. You're not necessarily always in alignment. Right? I mean, there's stuff in the mobile literature about phones being, at the end of the day, something that helps people be individuals from an identity perspective, different than other technologies have. But I don't think that's your question. I think your question is more about heterogeneity and market concentration and things all looking the same. And I am, I still think we're at a moment where we're in like a convergence period where these global app stores are still in the business of opening up more markets, and the top 10 things from market to market actually don't look that different. I mean, there's long tails, so there's lots of ways in which content here looks different from content in Kenya or content in Indonesia, but not enough, right? And to get a little cute, the operating systems are designed 7 miles apart from each other in Palo Alto and Cupertino. Right? It's a whole big world, and that's pretty damn tight. And so I think we'd like to see a little bit more heterogeneity.
Thank you very much,
Jonathan.
Thanks. Any other questions can be posted at the end of the session. Our next speaker is Alison Gilwood, and her talk will be titled Remarks from Development of ICTs or ICT for Development, Unblocking Development Theory, Studies and Practice. Alison Gilwood is the Executive Director of Research ICT Africa and an adjunct professor at the University of Cape Town's Graduate School of Business, Management of Infrastructure Reform Regulation Program. Prior to this, she was an associate professor at the University of Witwatersrand Graduate School of Public and Development Management, where she founded the Learning Information Networking and Knowledge Center, LINC, in 1999 with the purpose of cross-tracking ICT policy and regulatory training in Southern Africa. She did so after serving a term on the founding council of the South African Telecommunications Regulatory Authority, SATRA. Before she joined SATRA in 1997, she established the Independent Broadcasting Authority's Policy Department and was responsible for coordinating the triple inquiry into public service broadcasting, local content, and cross-media control. She was appointed to the African Ministers Advisory Group in 2000, and in 2002, she chaired the National Digital Advisory Body appointed by the Minister of Communication. She has served on the board of the public broadcaster, the South African Broadcasting Corporation, Women's Net, and Media Monitoring Project, and publicly listed company of WUSA. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Alison.
Thank you for that very long introduction.
And my apologies for just being dreadfully disorganized, confused, PA dependent who's on leave, poor following of my global information systems, and just messing up. So thanks very much to